Chapter 7 of Bindle by Herbert Jenkins. This LibriVox recording is in the public domain. Recording by Don W. Jenkins. Chapter 7. Bindle commits an indiscretion.
"Anyone would think you was goin' to a weddin'."
Mrs. Bindle eyed Bindle aggressively.
"Not again. I got one little canary bird. Two might make me unhappy."
Bindle had remembered his promise to his niece Millie in every particular, and had added as his own contribution a twopenny cigar resplendent in a particularly wide red and gold band, which he had been careful not to remove.
"Anythink might happen to me in this get-up," he remarked pleasantly, "so don't expect me till I'm home." "You never take me out," broke in Mrs. Bindle stormily, "but you can take that chit of a girl out first time she asks." "You don't like the pictures, Mrs. B. They ain't holy enough, and some of the young women in 'em are a bit generous, like, with showin' their ankles. But there, there." "You used to take me out before we was married," replied Mrs. Bindle, ignoring Bindle's remark.
Bindle looked at her curiously.
"Them was the days when yer wasn't above goin' to a music hall. There ain't nowhere to take yer except the chapel, and I don't enjoy it as you and Artie do."
"Where do you expect to go?" demanded Mrs. Bindle angrily.
She always became angry when mention was made of the pleasures she once enjoyed.
"Where do you expect to go to?"
"Well," remarked Bindle judicially, "according to you and Artie, it's a place where yer don't have to pay no water rates."
Mrs. Bindle sniffed derisively.
"Look here, my one and only," continued Bindle, "I got to 'ave a pretty bad time in the next world, according to what you and Artie believes, so I'm going to the pictures, and I'll 'ave a drink or two in this. If I was as sure of 'eaven as you and Artie is, maybe I'd be more careful."
Mrs. Bindle banged the iron she was using down upon the rest, but made no comment.
"Well, see you later, if I'm lucky," said Bindle, and he was gone.
He found Millie in a fervour of expectation. She opened the door to him herself, looking very pretty and smart in her Sunday hat.
"I was so afraid you'd forget, Uncle," she whispered, snuggling against him as they walked along. "You look so nice," she added.
Bindle looked down at himself and grinned.
"It pays for dressin'," he observed. "The cigar was me own idea. It gives a sort of finish, eh, Millikins?"
They walked past the Fulham Grand Theatre, and at the Cinema Palace on the Fulham side of the bridge Bindle paused.
"Not this one, the one over the bridge," Millie cried anxiously.
"Further to walk for your old uncle."
But, faltered Millie, "Charlie Chaplin's at the other, and I do so want to see him."
"Charlie Chaplin's here too, Millikins. Look, it says so."
"Oh, Uncle, please, please, the other one."
There were tears in Millie's eyes, and her voice shook. Bindle was puzzled, but to please her he would have walked over many bridges.
"Uncle, you are good," was all she said as she smiled at him happily.
They passed over the bridge in silence, watching the stream of trams, buses, and people. When with Millie, Bindle never ventured upon those little personalities in which he indulged when alone.
"Do you like chapel, Millikins?" Bindle inquired suddenly.
"I hate it, Uncle Joe."
There was such feeling and decision in Millie's voice that Bindle turned and regarded her curiously.
"Why?"
"I want to be happy. Oh, I do so want to be happy, Uncle Joe."
There was almost a sob in Millie's voice, and her eyes were moist with unshed tears. Bindle said nothing, but he pondered deeply as they walked slowly along. When they saw the brilliant lights of the Putney Pavilion, Millie visibly brightened. As they entered, Millie looked eagerly round, and a sigh of contentment escaped her as her eyes rested on a tall, pale-faced youth who stood smoking a cigarette. He raised his hat about an inch from his head, squaring his elbow in the process as if saluting. The action was awkward and sheepish. Bindle looked from the young man to Millie. Then, remembering Millie's distress at his suggestion of going to the other cinema, light dawned upon him. With elaborate courtesy, and to the youth's obvious astonishment, he returned the salute. Then, walking across, seized his hand and shook it effusively.
"Millikins, this is a young man I used to know, but have forgotten. He remembers me, however, and that's all that matters. This is me niece Millie," he added to the youth, who, staring in utter bewilderment from Bindle to Millie, stood with downcast head. "Goin' in to see the pictures?" Bindle inquired casually.
"Yes, of course," stuttered the youth.
"Nice evenin' for pictures," continued Bindle, thoroughly enjoying the situation. "Don't yer think so?" he added, as the youth did not reply.
"Yes, very."
"Now, you and me's old pals, but I've quite forgot your name. Is it Horace?"
"Dixon. Charlie Dixon."
A faint smile flickered across the young man's face as he caught Millie's eye. He was beginning to realize that somewhere in this astonishing adventure there was fun, and that Bindle had been first to see it. For some seconds, Bindle, who was a shrewd judge of character, regarded the young man. He was obviously nervous, but his grey eyes looked out honestly from a rather pleasant face into those of Bindle. Suddenly he laughed. Millie looked from one to the other, her pretty brows puckered. The situation was obviously beyond her.
"Uncle, I want to speak to you, please."
Millie's voice was scarcely audible.
"All right, my dear, we'll go and buy the tickets. You wait here, young feller," he added. "We'll be back in 2 ticks.
When out of earshot, Millie whispered shyly,
"That's Charlie Dixon, and we like each other, and I'm a wicked girl, Uncle Joe. I told him to be here, and..."
"That's all right, Millikins, don't you worry."
Millie gave his arm an ecstatic squeeze as he left her to purchase the tickets. When Bindle and his niece rejoined Charlie Dixon, Bindle's mind was made up. He liked the look of the young man. He also remembered his own youth, and a glance at the happy face of his niece decided him upon his course of action.
"How long have you known each other?" he inquired.
"More than 6 months," replied Charlie Dixon.
"Seems a lifetime, eh?" he grinned.
"I knew you'd understand, dear Uncle Joe," whispered the now radiant Millie.
"Look here," said Bindle to Charlie Dixon. "I just remembered I got to see a mate round the corner. You two go in with these tickets, and I'll follow in 10 minutes. If I misses yer, be here in this 'all at 10 sharp, see?"
They both saw and exchanged rapturous glances.
"Mind, 10 sharp, or I'll get the sack."
"Thank you, Mr. Bindle,"
said Charlie Dixon, raising his hat, to which Bindle responded with an elaborate sweep that brought a smile to the face of the attendant. Just before turning into Putney High Street, Bindle looked round to see Millie and Charlie Dixon in earnest converse, walking slowly towards the door leading into the pictures and bliss. Bindle sighed involuntarily.
"I wonder if I'd done right. Funny thing, me playing Cupid. Wonder what Mrs. B and Artie'd say. There's goin' to be trouble, J.B., and you're goin' to get yourself in an holy sort of mess. If it hadn't been for petticoats, you might have been mayor of Fulham or Charlie Chaplin."
At 9:45, Bindle left a merry group of intimates at the Scarlet Horse, and a few minutes later was waiting in the vestibule of the pavilion, where he was joined by the lovers.
"I never knew Millikins was such a pretty gal," muttered Bindle as they approached.
Then aloud,
"Where'd you two got to? I been searching everywhere."
With a wealth of detail, they explained exactly where they had been sitting.
"Funny, I didn't see yer," remarked Bindle. "Now you two must say good night, and," turning to the youth, "if yer'll follow across the bridge slowly, maybe I'll see yer outside the Grand Theatre after I've taken this young woman home."
Millie was strangely silent as the three crossed Putney Bridge. She was thinking deeply of her newfound happiness, and, as she gripped Bindle's arm with both hands, she felt that he represented her special providence. She could tell him anything, for he understood. She would always tell Uncle Joe everything. Outside Fulham Theatre, she said good night to Charlie Dixon.
"You ain't said a word since I met you, Millikins. What's up?"
inquired Bindle, puzzled at Millie's silence.
"I've been wondering, Uncle Joe," replied the girl in a subdued voice.
"What about? Tell your old uncle."
"I've been wondering why you are so good to me, and why you don't think me a wicked girl."
Then turning to him anxiously,
"You don't, Uncle Joe, do you?"
"Well, Millikins, there ain't anythink very wicked, so far as I can see, in wantin' to be 'appy in the way you do. Isnibs looks a nice young chap, and if he ain't, he'll wish he'd never seen your old uncle."
There was a grim note in Bindle's voice that surprised his niece.
"You don't think God minds us being happy that way, do you, Uncle Joe?"
questioned Millie earnestly.
"I'm sure he don't, Millikins. He's all for the 'appiness what don't do nobody any harm. That parson chap told me, and he was a dean or something, and he ought to know."
Millie drew a sigh of relief. Then her mood suddenly changed.
"Uncle, let's run," she cried, and without waiting for the protest that was forming itself on Bindle's lips, she caught him by the hand and dashed off. After a moment's hesitation, Bindle entered into her mood, and the pair tore up Fulham High Street, Millie running obliquely in front, striving to urge Bindle to a greater pace. Just as they reached the Hearty's private door, Mr. Hearty himself emerged on his way to post a letter. Millie, running sideways, did not see him. Bindle was unable to avoid the inevitable collision, and Millie's elbow took her father dead in the center of his waistcoat and drove the breath out of his body.
"Oh, father!" cried his horrified daughter.
"Millie!" gasped Mr. Hearty when he had regained sufficient breath for speech.
"My fault, Hearty. I likes a run now and again. We was having a bit of a race. Millikins beats me in the matter of legs."
To Mr. Hearty, women had limbs, not legs, and he disliked intensely Bindle's reference to those of his daughter.
"I hope this will not occur again," he said severely. "I shall have to stop these...
Unable to find the word, Mr. Hearty passed on to the pillar box. Millie stood watching him, horror in her eyes.
"Oh, Uncle Joe, am I a very bad girl? Father always makes me feel so wicked."
"He'd make an holy saint feel a bit of a rip. You're just about as bad as a first-class angel. But p'raps it'd be better not to old sports outside the shop. Might get me a bad name. Now in you go, young'un, and we'll have another bust next Friday, eh? I'll be seeing his nibs on me way home."
"Good night, dear Uncle Joe. I'm glad you're my uncle."
She put her arms round his neck and kissed him, and Bindle experienced a curious sensation in his throat.
"God bless yer, Millikins,"
Bindle mumbled in an unsteady voice as she tripped along the passage.
"Fancy me saying that," he muttered as he closed the door. "It kind o' slipped out."
A few yards down the high street, Bindle met his brother-in-law returning from the post.
"I'm sorry, Hearty, about that collision. It was all my fault. I like playing with kids."
There was an unaccustomed humility in Bindle's voice, assumed for the purpose of making things easier for Millie, that pleased Mr. Hearty.
"Millie is no longer a child, Joseph," he remarked, "but we'll say no more about it. I'm not hurt. Good night."
He bared his yellow teeth in token of forgiveness. As he passed on, Bindle gazed up at the skies meditatively.
"I wonder if God really likes that sort," he murmured with a seriousness that was unusual to him.
Outside the theatre he found waiting for him Charlie Dixon, who greeted him with,
"Will you bring her again, Mr. Bindle?"
"Here, I ain't a nurse, young feller. Nice mess you got me in. It's all through you that Millikins nearly killed their father. Ran clean into him and sort of knocked the wind out of his bellows."
Bindle told the story of the collision with great gusto.
"Now," he continued, "you and me's got to have a talk, and then we'll have a glass of beer at the same time."
Bindle learned the story of Millie's romance. It appeared that she and Charlie Dixon, who was in a shipping office, went to the city by the same train every morning, Millie being a typist at a wholesale draper's. Young Dixon had watched her week after week, and he eventually became acquainted owing to a breakdown on the line, which resulted in a corresponding breakdown of the passenger's usual reserve. After that they went up regularly together, met at lunch, after business hours, and on every occasion that Millie could possibly manage it. Once they had each obtained a half-holiday, which they had spent at the zoo. Charlie Dixon's frankness and obvious devotion to Millie Hearty entirely won Bindle's heart.
"You will help us, Mr. Bindle, won't you?" he pleaded. "Look here, young feller," said Bindle with an unusual note of seriousness in his voice. "I don't know nothing about yer, and before I helps I got to be sure what I thinks yer are. Now you just get me a letter or two from them as knows what sort of villain yer are, and then p'raps I'll be the same sort of old fool I been tonight. See?"
They parted with mutual regard and promises to meet again next Friday, when Charlie Dixon was to bring such documents as would vouch for his respectability.
"Yes, I been an old fool," muttered Bindle as he walked home. "This here business is going to lead to trouble between me and Hearty. What a pity people gets it as bad as Hearty. No man didn't ought to be religious all the week. It ain't natural."
That night Bindle entered his house whistling Gospel Bells with unaccustomed abandon.
"Been enjoying yourself, leaving me at home to slave and get your meals ready?" snapped Mrs. Bindle. "One of these days you'll come home and find me gone."
"Who's the man?" interrogated Bindle with a temerity that surprised himself. That night Bindle lay awake for some time thinking over life in general and the events of the evening in particular. He never could quite understand why he had been precipitated into an atmosphere so foreign to his nature as that surrounding Mrs. Bindle and Mr. Hearty. He had striven very hard to stem the tide of religious gloom as it spread itself over Mrs. Bindle. Unaware of the cause, he not unnaturally selected the wrong methods, which were those of endeavouring to make her cheer up.
"The idea of going to heaven seems to make her low-spirited," was Bindle's view.
Even Mrs. Bindle was not entirely proof against his sallies, and there were times when a reluctant smile would momentarily relieve the grim severity of her features. There were occasions even when they chatted quite amiably until the recollection of Mr. Hearty and the mental comparison of his success with Bindle's failure threw her back into the slough from which she had temporarily been rescued.
"There must be something funny about me," Bindle had once confided to Mrs. Hearty. "My father was as religious as a woman with one leg. Then I gets Lizzie, and she turns away from me and Mammon. I don't rightly know who he is, but she's always talking about him. Then you goes back on me and gives me a sort of brother-in-law who's as holy as ointment. You ain't been a real pal, Martha. Really, you ain't."
If called upon to expound his philosophy of life, Bindle would have found himself in difficulties. He was a man whose sympathies were quickly aroused, and it never troubled him whenever the object of his charity were a heathen, a Christian, or a Mormon. On one occasion, when a girl had been turned out of doors at night by an outraged father who had discovered his daughter's frailty, it was Bindle who found her weeping convulsively near Putney Pier. It was he who secured her a night's lodging and stood her friend throughout the troubled weeks that followed, although it meant neither beer nor tobacco for some months. On another occasion, a mate had been ill, and it was Bindle who each week collected what pence he could from his fellow workmen and made up from his own pocket the amount necessary to keep the man, his wife, and child. To do this, he had done work as a whitewasher and laborer, never working less than one whole night a week in addition to his regular occupation until his mate was well again. No one knew of these little acts, which Bindle kept profound secrets. He would have felt ashamed had they become known, more particularly had Mrs. Bindle or Mr. Hearty heard of them. Once he had remarked, apropos of some remark of Mr. Hearty's regarding what in his opinion would be heaven's attitude towards some unfortunate wretch who had stolen food for his wife, "I shouldn't like to have a god I'd sometimes have to feel ashamed of," whereat Mr. Hearty had become very red and embarrassed. End of chapter 7. Read by Don W. Jenkins, Rancho San Diego, California, shaggybark.blogspot.com.